vez, inglés, español. ¿Sí? ¿Seguro todo el mundo? ¿Entiendes? Do you understand Spanish? No. No, okay. We have to switch to English. No problem. Don't feel the pressure. I'm going to start now. First of all, I want to thank you for coming here and spend some time with me. It's something, you know, it's Saturday. There are a lot of good things to do. We are sunny, prefer to go to the beach. I want to thank the organizations to having done a slot to speak a little bit. I am Francisco Ramos from IBM. Okay, and the presentation or the talk is going to be about how a platform as a service can help me as a developer, or how it can help me to develop a solution. Okay. I have been working with clouds or making cloud applications last 3-4 years, okay, since Amazon Web Services started with the infrastructure as a service cloud, and then the new trends or the new evolution that we are facing that is moving to a platform as a service cloud, and well, I have taken some lessons learned, you know. I wanted just to share a little bit some key things that may be valuable when you have to face a development or implement a solution on a cloud environment, okay? First, and this is very important, you may think that it's not, but this is really, really important, to know what is a platform as a service cloud and what is the difference with an infrastructure as a service cloud. Everyone knows what is an infrastructure as a service cloud, more or less, no? Okay. Infrastructure as a service cloud is a cloud where you manage servers, storage, networking, and hardware that can be virtualized or not. Okay, what a infrastructure as a service cloud provides to you is a portal when you will see things like virtual machines, routing tables, storage like volumes in a SAN network, or a NAS, or things like that, or CPUs, things like that, okay? You see these concepts in a portal, this is an infrastructure as a service approach. In the other side, in the other hand, what we have is the platform as a service cloud. And this is a cloud where you deploy and manage, and hopefully develop, if they have tools, develop and test applications and middleware, okay? The concept here in a platform as a service is that you don't manage virtual machines. You manage applications and the things that your application needs to run, okay? And this is called services, typically. A service can be a database, but you don't go into a virtual machine and platform a database or install the database system and create instances, by the way, okay? The database instance is provisioned for you and you get a connection to the database. And this is a very important thing because every time that you think, I need a virtual machine with something, you should go for this kind of cloud, okay? This fits in you, how do you think? If you think that I need just a database or I just need to run a Java application, you fall down in this approach, okay? So if a virtual machines or infrastructure as a service cloud provides me everything that I need to do whatever, to install the operating system, the middleware, and etc. Why we are evolving to pass from the IaaS, no? Why we are rising a little bit the level? Because, you know, we are developers, and sometimes you have seen in a lot of presentations, we like to code or code or implement applications. We don't like to spend time still installing and configuring things. I'm a developer, but I have been acting as a system administrator for at least 5 years too. I run a CPD, and if you like IT computer science, at the end you like to install these things and to play a little bit with, let's say, storage, no? You have to set up a storage network. You like to play with your channel, the worldwide port names, you know, all this stuff, no? Networking, doing routing and VLANs or VPNs, but at the end we tend to automate all these things. And from the developer point of view, it doesn't bring a lot of value. This is something that you want to avoid, you don't want to deal with. So we like typically, or we are intended to develop our code, and then in a less extent, trying to fix the bugs that we create, learn new things. This is we like to learn things, and spend time going to the beach or having some drinks. And the order is very important, because if you drink before trying to fix, or if you drink, you can try then to learn new things. This is the best thing that you can do, instead of coding or trying to fix something. But, you know, and the other important thing that we have as an IT engineers is that we like to automate things. If you are a good professional in IT, everything that you see that you are doing something twice, you are thinking about how to automate that, okay? So if we like to automate things and we don't like to set up the environment, what we are trying to do is an evolution, an evolution. Automate all the processes to deploy and manage an application. Every time that we need to go to a network, create a VLAN, provision storage into a fiber channel software, or a SAN software, some volume controller software, set up the operating system, set up the middleware, and then install the application. Poof, this is you have seen maybe in other presentations that this is a lot of time spent. We tend to automate all this process, okay? So, and this is why we are now, there is a rise, or it's very trendy to have tools that try to automate all these processes. Okay, that is the reason why the last years we are seeing these kind of tools. Because it's nothing more than a logic evolution, okay? So, if you like, up to the moment, the approach of the platform as a service, when you want to go to this paradigm, this new paradigm, you have to consider several things that are very important. One is that it should be easy to use. This is may look very naive, but if you want to simplify things, the how to use the platform should be easy to, not complex, okay? The availability. You should look for a provider or a platform that gives you some, let's say, SLA, reasonable SLA, okay? There is a lot of new technologies, new products that you are going to see into the past world, and some of them will give you somewhere to deploy your application, but will not provide a production SLA. Okay, and this is very important. It will not come with a compromise. And you want a compromise, okay? You are playing, it's okay, no? But if you are deploying real systems, this is very important for customers. Scalability. You have seen also that it's very trendy that you create, you adapt the workload or your application just by clicking a plus or a minus icon, or issue some commands, and it creates new instances of your application, and it automatically is federated to a load balancer to distribute the workload. This is what you have to expect from a PaaS, okay? And what you should have in any PaaS cloud that you are looking for to deploy your application. Security issues. You have to make sure that everything is secure. You are not going to run into denial of service attacks and all this stuff. A lot of vendors or solutions or PaaS cloud doesn't defend you or prevent you to have an attack of this kind of type, because they only think that they have to automate the process of the project application, and they don't consider these kind of things. This is very important when you go to production systems. Inclusive, that's very important. Inclusive is the ability for the platform to handle things that are not prepared for that, okay? And we are going to see later, this is a, you know, when something comes, everyone, maybe there is a lot of people that start thinking, oh, this is very beautiful, this is what we want to use, this is the goal, where we want to go, but the reality is that there's a lot of applications and situations that doesn't fit very well in this new paradigm, okay? So, in a certain way, the cloud where you are deploying your application has to handle these situations, okay? And you maybe are looking at me thinking, why you are saying that? Because at the end, I'm a very simple person, okay? And I try to simplify concepts to understand. I see a cloud at the end like a bunch of servers connected with a network, That's it. That's the physical status of a CPD or a cloud. Okay. If this cloud works in one way, and you need to run a workload that doesn't fit, you have to put it on another CPD, on another cloud. Okay, maybe an IaaS cloud or whatever. And because they are different CPDs and they are connected to the internet, you have a cable that has to go to one place to another place. So maybe there are workloads like, let's say, a service of geolocalization that is not very critical to have a very high response time because you are sending an HTTP request through a REST API, okay? But there are other services like databases for a transactional system that there are a lot of data that is coming from the application server to the database. So the database cannot be outside of the CPD. It's not optimal for a real important application. Now, this is something that you have to consider when you are putting things into cloud, distributed, or on internet, okay? The traffic of information between the different pieces. And this is why it's important, because you are going to see that the platform as a service clouds provides you a lot of services, but in reality, probably not all the services that you need to build your application, okay? It's growing, we tend to add more functionality to cloud to be more attractive, more useful, ready to use in your applications, but at the end, you will face things that doesn't have in the platform as a service, and you will need to implement that on an infrastructure as a service approach. Okay, you will have to create a virtual machine and install some software because it's not available on where you are trying to deploy applications. You must have this functionality in your vendor, and this is very important because otherwise you can run into a stuck situation. You are trying to deploy your solution, and then you have to implement something that is impossible or very difficult to implement that approach, okay? And you have a real problem there. This is a no-go. You can continue in your project. So it's important to have this functionality, portability, the availability, the capacity of running your workload into a PaaS standard or a PaaS paradigm and move that to another. At the end, you have to think that this is like an onion, okay? We have different layers. You have to think that we have the infrastructure as a service layer on the center, more or less. And then we have another layer of platform as a service that abstracts all the management of the hardware systems or the infrastructure. Ideally, you should be able to move your applications that are running on the platform as a service layer to another infrastructure as a service implementation. So you can move from one hardware to another hardware. Typically, you're trying to run things on an OpenStack or something like that, open source or open standard. Okay, you are aware about OpenStack, Cinder, Nova, no? Well, it's an effort to try to standardize the infrastructure as a service. Okay, try to say, okay, we have to provision virtual machines with a CPU. How we are going to do that? Every vendor has their own ways. We are trying. There are some vendors that are trying to standardize the way to provision CPU, storage, networking capabilities, all the infrastructure things. And this is called OpenStack, okay? Anyway, because the PaaS is built on top of the IaaS, you try to communicate with the infrastructure in a standard way, no? Because you can change the infrastructure as much as you want. All the services that are available. This is very important. All the things that have your application to run. You try to maximize the number of database vendors that have that is available on the platform. You try to get some services. Let's say I'm trying to imagine for queues, for workflows. If you are developing mobile applications, to have push services, data synchronization. And now there's a lot of hype about cognitive computing, maybe services about cognitive computing, big data, all this the stuff. You try to have that on the platform as a service and ready to use by your application, okay? This is very important to have the maximum number of services available for you because they are ready to use. You don't have to implement that. You try to avoid to be vendor locking, and this is also very important. Because if you are locked to a vendor, you can move to another system, and if the vendor says that maybe tomorrow that is going to charge you twice, you are in a very bad position. So try to be very standard and be able to move from one vendor to another vendor your application. At least have the ability to run away. or to move in another place. So this is very important. To have a development framework and tooling. This is also very important. Applications that are meant to run in a PaaS may have something special code inside, let's say, okay? Special adaptations. So if there is some integration or toolkit into the development phase that helps you to build your application, it's very welcome. Okay, that's reality, okay? I would like to say, no, no, you can deploy a platform as a service application and you will be able to deploy that on any platform as a service cloud and you don't need to change your application. This is not real. This is, someone is lying to you, okay? You will have to change, maybe not a lot, but you have to think that maybe something has to be changed, okay? You have to take care about it. And you want also to have fast prototyping. Okay, why? Because when you are going to face the use of a platform as a service, you want to test it first. Before you go with your application or start coding, you want to test that everything that you want to do is feasible to do it. This is very important because you have to discard this vendor or other vendor or this platform as a service cloud and go for an infrastructure as a service. Okay. The major drawback when you are going to a platform as a service approach is that you have a lot of requirements, no? Or things that you would like to have. Like we said, we had listened that in the previous speech or talk, that it was try not to connect to SSH to a virtual machine. There's a lot of paths that doesn't allow you to connect through SSH to the container or the virtual machine that is running your application. And some applications need, or that someone connects to the virtual machine to set up whatever. You need to automate these steps, okay? And this is very important too. So, about reality, or what I have seen in these years, that there is some applications that doesn't fit really well in the PaaS layer or the platform as a service cloud. These applications or workloads are applications or workloads that can be virtualized, let's say, okay? Like big data workloads. If you have to do something with big data, it's much better to go to infrastructure as a service. In fact, we will see later that we have a wonderful PaaS. I'm going to explain what is the name and I will do a brief demo to illustrate all the things that I'm saying here. Okay, thank you. When we use the service for big data that is based on Hadoop, what is going to do that service is create a cluster of physical machines at the infrastructure layer. Okay, because it's much more optimal there than just creating virtual machines or something like that. So if your application is just big data or Hadoop based centric, it's better to move to an infrastructure as a service approach or cloud, okay? Also, some workloads or applications aren't good candidates to be run outside or in the public cloud. We have seen also that there's a trend to move applications to internet or a public cloud. But you know the difference between a public cloud and a private cloud or a dedicated cloud? This is another categorization of cloud. A public cloud is a cloud where everyone can connect. Okay, you can connect to Bluemix, you can connect to Amazon Web Services, you have your applications there, your virtual machine running. Amazon Web Services is an infrastructure as a service cloud. We are thinking about Heroku, Azure, okay? But you are there, your applications are there, and they are shared in all the IT infrastructure. This is why it's called public. Dedicated cloud is a cloud that reserves some physical resources only for you. Okay, so you have the guarantee that all the applications that are running are on your own network or are running on your dedicated servers. An on-premise cloud is a cloud that you have in your offices, in your CPD. Okay, this new approach is a trend, it's a reality. Everyone is going to the PaaS cloud. Okay, the thing is that for big customers or big companies, they don't want to have all their data or all their processes running on public cloud. They want to run it under control, under very, very heavy control. They want to have their data, their process running on the CPD, the local CPD. So we are trying to approach this new paradigm, but on premises, okay, at home, let's say. And then we have the hybrid cloud. The hybrid clouds are clouds that are running something here in my CPD, and at a certain point of time need to grab some resources outside, because at the end what we have here is limited. No? If we have 100 servers, we have 100 servers here. But if the workload that we need 200 servers, what are we going to do? Just grab 100 servers from the public cloud or a dedicated cloud that is outside. This is a new approach also. It's trying to extend dynamically the capacity of your local CPD. This is very important also. And the reality also tells us that you don't have only one architecture or one application. Maybe for a small application, yes, you have a solution. It's based on a language with a very defined set of services, database. You have very protected that, very standardized. But at the end, the real world and in enterprise level scenarios, you have a bunch of different languages, a bunch of different frameworks, operating systems, middleware is very complex, okay? And you have to handle that. That's why most of the platform as a service cloud allows you to run different applications in different languages, okay? Because at the end, we like Java, we are in a Java conference. I'm a Java programmer from my life, but then it comes one small application, one website or micro website that has done someone for our customer that is run on PHP or Node.js or whatever, and you have to handle that in your cloud. So a platform as a service cloud should be able to handle different applications in different languages, okay? And this is very important. Don't suffer. The technology is meant to help you to run your applications. Okay, if this doesn't fit easily, don't try to fit it into a pass, because you will have to face all the complexity, all the automatic tasks that are behind. And this is a big effort. Okay, it's not trivial. So if your application fits easily because you have done a prototype, you try to implement or deploy it, and it works, or you have to change a little things, perfect. If not, don't suffer. Go to the infrastructure as a service approach. Okay? You will lose less hair. I lost all my hair. So the technology is meant to help. And by the way, we have the perfect pass. One platform as a service cloud that covers everything. This is I'm going to do a little demo because you know on the slides everything works. But I want to connect to the portal. I'm going to try to create a Java application and modify it. We will see how the automating process of building the jar, the war, I mean, deploy it again into a development stage, and how it works together. Okay, it's very important to have an idea. I don't like a lot to do presentations because I work for IBM, and if you read. Typically, our papers about our products seems that our products are meant to be all the same. You don't know exactly what the product does, but they all reduces your TCO, maximize your production, and is the best product to use. But you don't know exactly what the product is. I'm going to do a sample. I'm going to try to do an example to illustrate what is a pass and how it's meant to use. Okay. And also very important, you have when you log in. You have a 30-day trial, and after that, you still have the ability to run your application. You have 365 gigabytes of RAM per month. That is more or less, the calculus is more or less like a half gigabyte application running 24 hours a day, all the days of the month, for free. It's free. You will not have to pay for that. I have friends that are using this platform to run their small websites, okay? And they don't have to pay for that. Even there are services, and we are going to see the services, there are database services that offers you, let's say, 100 megabytes of database for free too. So you can have a small application or an application with a database and you will not have to pay for that. And this is cool, no? In fact, we use that in high schools. It's used by the teachers of of, let's say, databases or programming languages for the students to use the platforms to deploy their practices, and it's provided, I mean, they have different agreements for students that they can have the platform for free for 1 year and for free with a limited set of capacity, okay? But in any case, if you tell the organizations your email and name once you are registered, I can extend the 30 days trial to 90 days. It's cool, it's 90 days. And the 90 days you will have 2 gigabytes of RAM. I mean, you can start applications as much as you want, but you will not have to pay up to 2 gigabytes of RAM, okay? Some key features about the platform as a service, or Bluemix, that is our platform as a service. It's based on Cloud Foundry. Anyone knows what is Cloud Foundry? You know what is Cloud Foundry. But anyone else knows what is Cloud Foundry? Cloud Foundry is an open source project that is a platform as a service cloud implementation. And everyone can download and see how it works. There are different vendors running on this open source project, like Heroku. Anyone has heard about Heroku? You? It's running on... In Heroku? Okay, that's cool. So you know very well how what you can expect from have services, have your application, and associated application. You will see that it's very similar here. By the way, last year, on summer last year, we were... Because this is why it's very important to be run on open source projects, on open standard. I went to Madrid to a customer, and we were able to move an application that was made on Ruby on Rails, and it was running on Heroku. We were able to move it to Bluemix in 1 day. So this capacity, and in the other way, the other way is possible. They could move from Huawei from Bluemix to Heroku in the same way, because at the end they are based on the same concept, okay? This is very cool. It's based on Linux containers. You have seen in other presentations on what are the Linux. Everyone knows what is a Linux container, and this is very, very important compared with an infrastructure as a service cloud. A Linux container is an evolution, let's say, the next level of a kind of a virtual machine, okay? When you have virtual machines, you are thinking about an infrastructure, you are virtualizing the CPU and the operating system and the storage, okay? At the end, you have to move big files of a few gigabytes, okay? When you're trying to have a elastic capacity into a cloud, what you are going to end is to cloning a virtual machine at an infrastructure level, okay? And then you need solid storage disks. You need a very powerful storage networking, and it's very expensive. And because you have to start the operating system every time that you start a node or a worker for your application, it takes some time. Okay, we are talking about it can take in order of minutes. Minutes, I mean 10 minutes, 15 minutes, okay? When we move to Linux containers, what you are going is to fork the kernel process. And this is like creating a virtual machine in less than 1 second. And this is very important. These are the Linux containers. On the Linux containers, we have different kind of implementations that they are using the same API. Cloud Foundry uses something called Warden containers. Okay, Dockers are another kind of Linux containers, but they are based on the same API and the same capacities. A different approach to use it, but in the same way. Dockers are more closest to the infrastructure as a service layer. Okay, they are kind of a virtual machine that you can platform. And this is because they have become very popular, because system administrators can platform a Docker container like if they were platforming or setting up a virtual machine. That's why it's growing a lot. To have things deployed on Cloud Foundry is a little bit more tricky, because it heavily relies a lot on coordination of different things. I'm not going into detail. I ran a workshop of 1 day explaining the internals, so you can imagine the things that are behind of that. But Bluemix is able now to run also Docker containers, and this is also very, very interesting. And even virtual machines. I have said earlier that virtual machines are at the infrastructure level, right? But at the end, the reality has told us, we started only with Cloud Foundry, but let's say we started with a set of services. But then customers came and said, ah, I want a Mongo database. Oh, hell, we don't have Mongo database. We can use your platform as a service. No. Now you can create a virtual machine or a machine, install Mongo database there, and if you want, it can be run or used by your application. You have the ability to go to a lower layer, do whatever you need at an infrastructure level, and use it as a, in the platform as a service layer. Okay? It can be a little bit tricky, but it's just a matter of being able to do what you need to do at the right side. Okay? We have more than 100 services. We started last year with 30. Every week there is a new service there. It's open. There are a lot of companies that are trying to put new services. We are going to see a few of them. We have a DevOps environment integrated inside. That is very cool to develop applications and automate the stages of build and deploy in different scenarios, in different spaces. And we support now the hybrid cloud models. We have the support of running your application into the public cloud or on-premise and connect through VPN or a gateway, let's say secure gateway service, to somewhere that you need to connect to get or invoke APIs or processes remotely. And this is very important too. Because at the end, big enterprises have some processes that want to are meant to run locally, and the application that you're running on the public cloud needs to connect there or get some data. This is possible to do in a secure way, okay? Now it's time for a demo. Hopefully it will work. I will try to explain a little bit. By the way, you are seeing it interesting? Yes? Do you think that this is where we are going, more or less? Maybe you have seen, it's very difficult because when I attended also the conferences, and I've seen that every speech or every person who is talking explain the same things, no? The automation, the automating the, all the processes, the services that you can log, and seems that we are saying all the same, no? But you know, it's the trend, and it's something that we go there, if we like or not. So this is the website. I'm going to do a login from the very beginning. Okay, thank you. Right now there are two regions where Bluemix are available. One is US South in Dallas from the States. Another one is on UK, okay, that is covering Europe. In any case, we have a roadmap to deploy Bluemix and every soft layer CPD. Soft layer is our infrastructure as a service product. Okay, we have a network of CPDs worldwide at the infrastructure level. It's called SoftLayer, and we have one in Paris, another one in Frankfurt. We have an access point in Sardanyola here in Barcelona, so we have a highway connection to a CPD here in Spain. And Bluemix is on top of that, okay? It's coordinating all the hardware. Okay. I don't know if to switch to... Now I'm accessing to the US South instance. If the internet works, it takes a while. I don't know why. I'm going to switch to here. You can switch to United Kingdom. I'm going to switch because here I have at least 20 applications, and I'm going to switch to United Kingdom and cut the communication. Because it's going to be more what you are going to face when you connect the first time. It's going to be empty. Okay, you are not going to see a lot of applications there. You are start using it. So here, now I'm working with the United Kingdom. In any case, you can deploy your application whatever you want. Eh? You want to deploy in the States? No problem. You can deploy there, or and it's going to be accessible through internet the same way. So what I'm going to do here, you will see different spaces. I will tell later that we have a YouTube video channel with all the some videos about this technology. In fact, we have a playlist specific for Java, about 18 videos. Okay. So here we have spaces that are nothing more than organizational units. We can have one space for development, another for production, one for one customer, another customer. Here we have the applications running under the Cloud Foundry paradigm and the services associated to that. I'm going to create one to see how it works. It's a web application. Of course, I'm going to choose the Java runtime. We have several languages. One important thing about this this platform as a service cloud is that it's agnostic to the language of the applications that is running inside. Okay, there's a component called Buildpack that has the responsibility to set up the Linux container with whatever is needed for your application. I'm imagining if you have an application that is based on Java, the responsibility of the Buildpack is to set up install a GDK, install an application server, and deploy your WAR or your ER. Okay? If there is a Node.js for whatever is needed, PHP, the same. So I'm going to use a Java runtime. Here you can see the 75 gigabytes of RAM hours free each month. You do the calculus, it's one application of half gigabyte running for free. We can call it Java Users Group app. Okay. Ah, it's being used. Someone used it. Okay. Let's choose a one. Inside. And now it's deploying a sample application. You know, sample applications are what work. The Hello World works in every language, in every cloud, always, no? The things are getting more difficult when you try to do real things. It's a pity because in the workshop, we ran a workshop yesterday that I was not able to finish. But we were showing how to connect to a database, expose it as a service, and how the application doesn't have to have the drivers embedded. You don't need the drivers because what is doing the build pack for you is to creating the data source definition automatically in the application server. You have a database, you associate the database to the application, and what is doing the system behind is defining the data source and injecting the drivers of the vendor of the database that you are using in your application. So your application only needs to do a context lookup on the Java directory name, okay, to get the data source instance object, to get the connection to the database. It doesn't have to handle the user, the password, the IP, the database name, anything like that. It's completely automated. So here we have our applications deployed. It's a very basic Hello World application. Here it's working. Now we are going to see, here is an overview of about our application, that is the URL. The URL is unique, and is here we have the number of instances. Instances are like nodes in a cluster. We could have as many as we want. You have seen in other presentations too. You can increase the number just by clicking these two arrows to increase or decrease or put the number, or you can even use a auto-scaling service to detect when your application has a heavy workload and automatically provision more resources. And then here we can see also the memory used by each instance, the availability for our quota. I'm going to add a Git repository. Why? Because I'm going to access the source code of the application. What it's going to do right now is deploy the source code of that application on a Git repository for me to be able to see what is running. Normally, on a regular basis, it's going to be in the other way. I'm going to have the Git repository and deploy that on a cloud platform, okay? But it can be in the same, it's valid too. I mean, I don't want to do it in the other way because it's a little bit more complex and I don't have time. I don't want to run out of time again. How much time do I have? It ends at 8:30, no? Okay, 8 minutes, okay. It says that it's going to only take a minute to clone the repository. So what I'm going to end at the end is to have the source code on a Git repository on the DevOps DevOps services for Bluemix product. That this is the DevOps environment integrated into the Bluemix platform. Okay, Bluemix is the environment, the runtime environment, and DevOps services for Bluemix is the development phase of this or the addition to this runtime environment. Here I have the code. What I'm going to do is to edit the code. Now what it's going to do is to clone this Git repository into a Eclipse Orion editor, one workspace. Do you know what is Eclipse Orion? No, you know what is Eclipse? Okay, you have to think about having an Eclipse on a web, on the web, not having Eclipse locally. This is another trend that we are facing. Everyone has to code through a browser. This is a trend, or this is a big effort that for us as a developers, we use browsers to code our applications. I don't know how it's going to end. I'm an Eclipse fan. I prefer to use Eclipse to code because it has a content assist, wizards, all the stuff. But at the end, you have to set up a workstation to have a running environment to do the regular tests on the machine. And it can be a little bit complex when you are doing cloud things, okay? But in any case, this is like a web Eclipse. Here we can see the files, the artifacts. As you can see, there is not a package view of the Java application. It's agnostic to the language. They have some plugins to be able to handle different kind of files. Okay, so I'm going to go here. We have the web content with the index and okay. 5 minutes. And the sample application has one dynamic part exposed as a REST API, and one static part exposed as a HTML page, okay, with a Java AJAX call. I'm going to change that one. Type text. Oh, I'm editing too much, making mistakes. Hola. Okay, and I'm going to save that. Now that I have saved the file, I'm going to do that change of the code as valid into the Git repository. You have to think that I'm working like an Eclipse, local Eclipse editor. I have modified a file, but I need to push that to the Git repository, right? So that's why what I am going to do right now. And I say, hello, message. And I'm going to commit. Now, what is going to do right now, when I do the push, I have done the commit, now I'm going to do the push to the branch master of this Git repository, it automatically has created a couple of stages into the build and deploy function that is automatically building the application. Building the application means constructing the WAR. It automatically is going to construct or build the WAR file through an AND task. Okay, when is executed that? It's executed every time, it can be configured, but it's done automatically every time that I do a push into a Git repository branch. I can see the logs about how it's running the AND task. I can see the artifacts generated. I can run GUnit test also to check that the build has done correctly. And if everything goes fine, it passes the artifacts generated in this stage goes to the deploy stage, okay? The deploy stage is trying to deploy the application into Bluemix automatically too, okay? Every of these steps can be configured. You can choose AND as a builder, but you can choose also Maven, Gradle, Grunt, NPM, any Bash script you can configure too if you want to use other tools, not a problem. And the deployment also, you can execute this task automatically or manually. Typically, you are doing that automatically when you are moving to a quality assurance scenario. And maybe you have another stage to deploy on production. So when your application is deployed automatically on quality assurance and you leave it running, maybe for 1-2 days or 1 week, and seems to be stable, you move that to production manually. Okay, you can configure that in that way. And since that is going to be deployed correctly, I can see the logs here. You can get the artifacts, you can download the word, whatever you want to do. We can see here the stage, all the logs of executing the ant task. If we have a build.xml file to execute the ant task, we can see, we could track the changes, we could assign the defects or new features and track that through the track and plan feature of the DevOps portal and see the changes on this concrete build, new features that has been implemented, but I don't have time to show that. Hopefully, if I do a refresh of the application, I should be able to get the new message on the Java application. I have modified the Java application, I have compiled the Java application, and I have deployed the Java application on cloud without zero work instance. This is not realistic, just trust me. It's cool to do a demo, but I prefer to use Eclipse locally. For me, it's more productive. But using in another languages that doesn't require maybe to code or have a workstation set up, you can do pretty much everything you need through the web editor. Okay. So, to finish, we have a meetup. We are going to meet the 1st of July. You can join or not. Sorry to some publicity or advertising on our meetup. We have a YouTube channel with Spanish videos. There is a lot of English videos too in YouTube. You only have to look for Bluemix videos. But I upload some videos in different languages for different purposes about Bluemix. And you can go there, and if you are interested, take a look and consume this information if you find especially useful. And I want to say also that if you are a startup, we have a special program that we provide $1,000 of credits for consume into Bluemix or EAS for every month. Okay? We finance that. So if you are a startup, you have consolidated one startup and it's a company, you can access this program. This is the URL. We are going to provide the presentation, so don't need to write anything. By the way, the demo that I have shown, or a little bit more applications, okay. You can see that on the YouTube channel, okay? And we have a challenge that you can win a prize, a small watch, if you want to participate. But unfortunately, the challenge is not run by us in Spain. It's a worldwide effort, or a European effort, and you will have to code in JavaScript. But that's all. I don't know if it's what you wanted or you found it interesting. I know this takes some time, but I wanted to do the demo, into the real cloud to show you a little bit what we are trying to do, okay? And this is more or less the paradigm that we are going to move in the next coming months or even years, okay? So thanks. If you have any question? No? Yes, please, go ahead.
How do you manage the application version? Currently, you develop version 1. Now I want to develop version 2.
You could have different spaces for different versions of your application. Even you could have a front end, we have seen in other workshops, the concept of a reverse proxy. You want to access your application, and this application, this small application, redirects your request to the correct version of the application that is meant for you as a user or as a tester, based on the path, let's say, or the URL. You could do that also. You can have a different version of the Git repository, different branches of the Git repository, and you can have the different spaces to deploy different versions of your application. Good, very good question. You can have, sorry for extending, but there are questions. You can have different instances of the data spread in different spaces, and they are different. It's a pity that you haven't attended yesterday's workshop, but it's on the YouTube channel. I show how to create a couple of instances of databases. One database is in the development phase with some data, and another database is in production space, and you move your application transparently from the development to production, or quality to production, and you don't have to change your application, just simply the application is connecting to the new database instance and taking the new data, completely transparent. That's all. So thanks a lot for coming.